should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus says my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when songs give way to sighing, and hope within me I draw closer to him. From care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. So I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. Oh, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. Yes, yes, I know he watches. I know he watches over me.
As I reflect on the last 35 years of my life, it's extremely difficult to imagine the man who I've called Pops from my preteens until my most recent visit to Barbados last month is no longer here or is no longer going to be there to welcome me to his home and, most importantly, welcome me with his favorite saying. Whenever he would see me, he would often, or whether he heard from me, he would often say, "You ain't nothing at all." That was always his favorite line for me for many, many years. And, you know, it's so hard to imagine visiting home and not hearing those words from Pops. But on my last visit, it was really interesting because in addition to telling me that "you ain't nothing at all," he would then punctuate it with, "But you've been gaining some weight, you know, and I've been working on it, so mommy, you'll have to be the one to make sure you keep me in check." But, you know, he always would inquire about my health and the fact that he felt like I spent so much time working, that he would always remind me about taking time to relax and taking time easy. And of course, when he made his fun with me, Jackie and mommy would often laugh and, you know, find it really funny at how he could be anywhere in the house, and when I show up, it was a given that Pops will come out just to engage me in very spirited conversation. Pops was constant in my life. From the very first day we met when I was a preteen, you know, I automatically felt like a son to him. And my family quickly became a part of his family. He would always ask about my mom and my sisters and, you know, whether they saw him in Bridgetown while he was at work or if he drove by the house. He would always engage them in lots of conversation. And of course, he'll always ask about me as well. And it's so rare that you would find individuals, especially now, who genuinely care about people, who would selflessly give of themselves and expect absolutely nothing in return. And that was the kind of man that Pops was. For him, it was always about making a personal sacrifice for others. He was selfless and thoughtful. His quick wit and conviction in his beliefs were characteristics that I've always admired. Pops was a family man. He loved his family unconditionally, and he was very protective of them. And he celebrated their successes, and he was a tower of strength as they faced any challenges. And even for me, you know, as I faced a life-changing moment 25 years ago, after a near-death experience in a vehicular accident, you know, he consistently would be looking out for me and ensuring that I was doing better and always looking to see how he can assist me. That is the kind of man that he was. His concern for others was immeasurable. It's so hard to think of the treasured memories with Pops without reminiscing on our long conversations in the patio at Burke's Road. But as I got older, it was the conversations about politics that, you know, I really looked forward to. He was very passionate in his beliefs. And purposely, whenever there was an election on the horizon, I would make it a point to come home and to go visit Pops so that I can offer a differing opinion, because he would be very firm in his convictions in telling me that my predictions were not going to be the case. And we would really enjoy some great back and forth as he shared his own views. But I think the moment that I treasure the most was the opportunity that we got to travel to St. Kitts together just a few years ago. And immediately it felt like old times in Burke's Road when I was a child again, as we were all in the same house. Like, there was so much fun that permeated the entire home. We had such great conversations on every drive. There was always something dramatic happening that, you know, we would just get one big laugh about. Of course, there was great food. And, you know, those memories with Pops are memories that I will always cherish, because this was a place that he had visited as a younger man, and being able to share those memories with him in St. Kitts and hear about his experiences there further reaffirmed for me the nature of the man and the ability of the man to share insights that will forever have an impact on the lives of the people that he touches. And those are memories that I will forever cherish. Pops, I never thought that this day will come, and I felt like we had so many more celebrations together, but thank you for making an indelible impact on my life. Thank you for welcoming me into your home and making me feel like a son to you from the day we met. Thank you for the genuine interest that you have shown in me and my family. And it's truly hard to imagine all my future visits to this island and all my future visits to the home and not seeing you there and not engaging with you in conversation. But the one thing that I have that I am so grateful for you to have given to me, and that is a spirit of understanding the importance of making a difference in the lives of the people that you meet. And I think if there's a lesson that all of us can take from Pops, and that is wherever we go, we never know what someone might be going through. We never know what challenge they may be facing, but it's so important that we take a moment and we give them an encouraging word, that we do something kind to them, because that is the kind of man that he was. And I think the best way that we can remember him, the best way that we can celebrate his life, is through our ability to exemplify the very characteristics that made him the incredible man that he was. He was small in stature, but he was certainly a giant of a man. Pops, my prayer is that you will rest in peace and rise in glory. And thank you for all that you've done for me and my family and everyone that you've impacted. Thank you.
Good morning. Daddy, William Sion Greenidge, was born to Albertha Lashley and Joseph Blackman on January the 12th, 1933. He enjoyed his boyhood days playing cricket in the Bayland with the likes of the right excellent Sir Garfield Sobers and building scooters. As he grew, he was quite the looker, with his signature sideburns, bow tie, and white shoes. Whenever he would return home from the United States, people would be peeping around corners and through windows to catch a glimpse of Mummy as he passed by. Mummy admits that she was one of the people looking to see him whenever he returned home, as she would pass his house frequently, hoping to catch a glimpse of him and thereafter to capture his heart, and that she did. Daddy married Joycelyn Greenidge on December 18th, 1971, at the Hawthorne Methodist Church. 51 years of marriage is no easy feat, but they accomplished it. Before marriage, Daddy had three daughters, Veronica, Marcia, and Beverly. My sister Karen and I came later. Daddy spoke glowingly of those days when he traveled. His work endeavors took him to places like St. Kitts and the United States. He also traveled for leisure and often reminisced about his travels abroad. I remember him bringing gifts like roller skates. I had the blue and Karen had the red. And dolls. Karen had the one with the blonde hair, and mine was with dark brown hair. His entrepreneurial spirit was one of the hallmarks of his legacy.
Hello?
After being a line crewman at the Barbados Light and Power Company, he ventured into taxi operation. As children, we will remember Daddy working his taxi in St. Lawrence Gap. Oftentimes, he will come home with a box of Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC now. That warm box of Kentucky served me, my sister Karen, my mom and dad, And I always wondered how that one box of KFC could serve an entire family satisfactorily. He also butchered pigs for holidays like Easter and Christmas and sold the pork to the neighbors. He enjoyed a good piece of baked pork, ham and sauce on Saturdays. Daddy loved ice cream. And my sister Karen fondly recalls the recent lunch where after enjoying a hearty meal, he simply asked her, "Where is the ice cream?" It was his entrepreneurship that allowed him to own his own home and to change his taxi throughout the years to newer models. Daddy operated his taxi for years, and he would leave home before 7 a.m. and return before 5 p.m. to beat the traffic. As a professional, Daddy offered his customers excellent service, and he was not one to overcharge them. He was trusted to pick up children from school and deliver them to their parents. Elderly ladies waited on him to take them home with their groceries. I met a lady recently when she saw me driving his taxi, and she inquired about his well-being because he took her son to and from school, and she wanted him to do the same for her younger son. She was so disappointed when I told her that Daddy was no longer driving. He operated by the Parliament next to the Treasury building in the Nelson taxi stand, and his customers included staff from the Treasury. He also drove the secretary of one of the former prime ministers. He drove his car until the age of 91. He was a skillful driver, and I cannot recall him ever being in an accident. When we were children, he would take us to visit friends every Sunday in St. George, and he would skillfully drive to and from the destination. My mother recounts that one time he avoided a major crash by driving into a cane field and then back onto the road. My mother says Daddy loved driving, and when Daddy was on the highway, he would pick up speed, and she would have to say, "Wait, William, where you going like a rocket?" With the coming of the COVID-19 pandemic, he retired from taxi operation, but often joked that he was going back down to town to work. His brain was quick and active, and so was his mouth. Daddy was well-versed on political and social issues and would engage in a serious debate on current affairs. He listened to the BBC News. He had a love for down-to-brass facts and tell it like it is. My father did not joke when it came to education, and I had to present my report to him at the end of the term. And although I thought I might have done so well, his face signaled to me that I had to aim higher. Daddy bought a newspaper every day, and at the dinner table, he would be discussing the latest issues. My father found time to relax, often sitting on the veranda when he was in Britain's Hill, with his legs elevated, looking at the airplanes as they flew by. He had a hammock for years, and he would lay there enjoying the beauty of nature. When he went to the beach, I remember he would jump into the water with a splash and swim around with strong strokes in the salt water. Daddy lived a long and fulfilling life, attending services here at the St. Patrick's Roman Catholic Cathedral until the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic. He will be fondly missed by his entire family, neighbors, friends, and customers. As the poet Shannon Lee asserts in her poem, entitled, "I Am Free," if parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Ah, yes, These things I too will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish for you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full. I savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Daddy, you have left us a long-lasting legacy. Rest in peace and rise in glory.
Please stand. We welcome William Sion Quidditch in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all,
and with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, William died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Opening hymn.
The King of Love, my shepherd, love is God. And rejoice in God. God made life. Oh, guide me. Of days, never.
Good morning, everyone. And here we are to say thanks to God for the life, for the gift of William to us, William Greenidge, a member of this church, a faithful member of this church. In fact, let me just tell you very quickly, I don't think anybody who don't know me, but if you don't, I'm Father Clement Paul, and I happen to be the lucky one in this parish for a little under 30 somebody years as the administrator here. And as administrator, obviously, this gentleman would have been quite a faithful and staunch member. In fact, I'm no longer the priest here. I'm the priest ordained in St. John. And on Wednesdays, nothing, literally nothing, stopped me from going to St. John to be there no later than 10 o'clock for my office there. And when Kathleen said, Father Paul, there's a funeral. I'm sorry to ask you that, but he's getting bad on Wednesday. I said, Kathleen, no. People, Father Paul, they asked for you, you know. So those are, thank you very much. So I said, Kathy, no, not Wednesday morning. I mean, it's the one morning. And then he said, but you know him, you know, and they asked for you, Father Paul. So I said, well, Kathy Ann, I just can't do it. And she said, all right, I'll ask Father Vibert. And I said, but I started feeling bad. William, even in death, you have your own way. Because you know why? Because you kept troubling me. So I thought, oh God, I can't do that. And then Deacon George, who was the other minister, he told me, Papa, you know him? And I said, oh my God, yes, I do. And it kept bothering me, saying, no, if I can't do William, then no, no. And I said, no, but I can't go. And I'm not, two people waiting up there for me, all I know. I said, I'll be there Wednesday morning, really. I thought, I can't do it. So Father Webster and I came down the stairs. He has prayer meeting. And I said, you will go. I said, I will go. And he asked me to extend condolences to the family at this time as well. So I am glad that I be here because at least I should do this much for William, as I said, who was literally a faithful. And when he came to church, he would watch me and he would listen very intently to what I was saying. So I think I owe him that much to be here this morning. So I'll do this ceremony first, but I'll have to leave at some point. If when you see me hopping out, it's only because my knee reminds me that I am no longer young, that's all. But other than that, I'm okay other than that. Let us pray. Oh God, of loving kindness, listen favorably to our prayers. Strengthen our belief that your Son has risen from the dead, and our hope that your servant William Greenidge will also rise again. We ask this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
People, you see me when I'm in the pulpit, and I say for you, Amen. Mm-mm. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. That's what I want here. Be seated now for the reading.
Good morning. I will be reading from Acts of the Apostle. Peter addresses Cornelius and his household. The truth I have now come to realize, he said, is that God does not have favorites, but that anybody of any nationality who fears God and does what is right is acceptable to him. It is true, God sent his word to the people of Israel, and it was to them that the good news of peace was brought by Jesus Christ. But Jesus is Lord of all men. You must have heard about the recent happenings in Judea, about Jesus of Nazareth and how he began in Galilee after John had been preaching baptism. God anointed him with the Holy Spirit and with the power. And because God was with him, Jesus went about doing good and carrying all who had fallen into the power of the devil. Now I, and those with me can witness to everything he did throughout the countryside of Judea and in Jerusalem itself, and also to the fact that they killed him by hanging him on a tree. Yet 3 days afterwards, God raised him in life and allowed him to be seen, not by the whole people, but only by certain witnesses God had chosen beforehand. Now we are those witnesses. We have eaten, drunk with him after his resurrection from the dead, and he was ordered us to proclaim this to his people, and to tell them that God has appointed him to judge everyone alive or dead. It is to him that all prophets bear this witness, that all who believe in Jesus will have their sins forgiven through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. George. I thought so. But that my boy then?
Yeah,
I thought so. Tell us. Thank you. goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling shall be.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This Bible reading will be taken from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 2. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. This is the end of the Bible reading. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel.
May the Lord be in your heart and on your lips as you proclaim his good news to us in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
On arriving at Bethany, Jesus found that Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days already. Bethany is only about 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had came to Martha and Mary to sympathize with them over their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus had come, she went to meet him. Mary remained sitting in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died, but I know that even now, whenever you ask of God, he will grant you." "Your brother," said Jesus to her, "will rise again." Martha said, "I know he will rise again at the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. If anyone believes in me, even though he dies, he will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." "Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she said. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who was to come into this world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. As the procession came in, I noticed that there are some young people and children in the congregation. I asked them to stand. Young children and young people in the congregation, just a few of you. a message for you. You see you all? Just remain standing with me, please, young people and children. You see how you all are? Let me tell you something now. I was young like you all. And before the cat can lick it, look where I am now. If I sit down for too long, my knee tells me it is in charge of me, not one of them, right? So I was just like, you know, run straightly up and they used to say I walk like a madman. I just walk to north, I was like you. And in no time at all, age stepped in for me. And I always felt, you know, boys and girls, I would live on and on and on. I will, if you find myself to the adults, I just want to tell you something. This gentleman we bury here today, he was your age too at one point. And after we were standing with some of those runs for our World Cup. We get 92, Lord, I've got a lot of runs here. But in other words, he lasted very long. But that's not the end of him, eh? I'm telling you now, that's not the end. This is the end of his body. Because the body too old now, it can't carry me. The body says, Mr. Granite, I carry all your amenities. I can't go anymore. I'm gone. The body, not Mr. Greenwich. He ain't gone, eh? He will never die. His body is died, and therefore one day he will live again. Now, if he could come back and talk to you, if God said, go back and tell, only one thing, you have one, go back and one thing, and come back. He will come and tell you, try and live a good life, so that when you come to die, we will all be together in heaven forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever, more than the energizer bunny. Be seated now. God bless you. The message for the older ones. After we said a long talk, thank you all very much, because you know what that means. You all made it for me very easy. But thank you very much for that. Jesus said to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me, even though he dies, will live. Now that is the more, if you put that in any computer, it will get a virus. To die and live, they don't make sense. They're two opposites, die and live. But are they? Our Lord, in talking to Martha, is saying to her and saying to us, death, as I told the children, death is a movement from one kind of existence, a physical kind of existence, to the real existence of which we were born, life with God. That's what it's all about. Today, we are sad to see him go because it is in this body that we were able to know him. It's in this body that we were able to love him. And that body can no longer be here with us. But he lives on. I am asked, listen, people, family, friends, members of this congregation, I ask them, I tell them, that as sure as today is Wednesday, this man lives on. And you know why? Because of that. That is why, you see that cross there? That's why that day. That tells us that had been destroyed, death. By his dying and rising. You see this there? That's for forever and ever, you know. That supports me forever and ever. And God said, no. I make, now hear my words, I make any human being, none, no, I make any human being for that to be the final say in their lives. No human being. Now people, I don't have the time this morning to go into detail about it. We're discussing it. Now that makes sense to some extent. You know why? Because for me to believe that when, thank God, you know, you can't hear me saying this. When Netanyahu and the other one, Putin, and the gangs in Haiti when they come, when they die, that them being dead forever and ever, why I'm pleased with that? I've got all that rubbish material, and when he dead, that's the story. That, not me, you know, it's in the Bible. God, when he's hanging on the cross on that Good Friday, a thief, and inside the actual South place is a criminal, you know, that's what you use. They were two criminals. And one said, Jesus, remember me. He said, you remembered, you okay. You know that? A big time criminal. I mean, you mean that metonymy there? Oh, Lord God, come again, let's try again. Let's try listen. No, God. But that's what it is. I'm, if not me, I would love to say different. That's what the Bible is. In other words, what I'm saying here today, I'm asking you to bury Mr. William Greenwich with all the confidence that he who lived, suffered, and died will rise again. Why? Because he, like Martha, believed in the resurrection. God bless you. Amen. Please, so we now have the prayers. Please stand for the prayers.
Please stand for the prayers.
God the Almighty Father, raised Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
Your response would be, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For William, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our brother William, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the praise we offered for our departed brother. Cleanse him of his sins and grant him the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
And so we now have the offertory, be seated for the offertory. And again, may God continue to bless all of you. I'm not going to the office, but I rest assured of my continuing prayers for you and the family and the relatives. And I hope I left with a message that William, hopefully all of us, will rise again at the resurrection, because the resurrected life has conquered by dying and rising. God bless you. Be seated. Offer to him.
Offer to him.
George, come. Let me try.
You all please now stand and join me in saying the prayer that our Father taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. But deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now it comes to the time you do the final commendation. For those who are not Catholics, normally William was welcomed into this church by baptism. We are sending back to God by the same sign that he received when he entered in the church. And all I'm going to do is walk around the coffin and just sprinkle it as I did when I make the entrance with his body into the church. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother William, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon William in this life. There are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever and ever. Amen. Now we come to say farewell. We're going to take William to his temporary resting place. It is just temporarily. He won't be there forever. He will rise on the third day. In peace, let us take leave of our brother. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Eternal rest grant unto you, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon you. May you rest in peace. As we leave this station to go to the other station, we go out singing the hymn. Funeral director. Thank you.
As I request, please silent all telephones, or in other words, turn them off. Put them on silent. You can still take your photos. We are about to presume before committal of William Sion. Our brother William has gone to his rest in the peace of Christ. May the Lord now welcome him to the table of God's children. With faith and hope in eternal life, let us assist him with our praise. Let us pray to the Lord also for ourselves. May we who mourn be reunited one day with our brother. Together, may we meet Christ Jesus when he who is our life appears in glory. Scripture says, to be precise, from Matthew 25:34, come you who are blessed by my Father, says the Lord, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And John 6:39 says, this is the will of the one who sent me, says the Lord, that I should lose anything of what he gave me, but that I should raise him up on the last day. Lord Jesus Christ, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you hallowed the grave of all who believe in you, and so made the grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection as it claims our mortal bodies. Grant that our brother William may sleep here in peace until you awaken him to glory, for you are the resurrection and the life. Then he will see you face to face, and in your light will see light and know the splendor of God, for you lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Because God has chosen to call our beloved brother William out of this life to himself, we dare commit his body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace, now and forevermore. Amen. For our brother William, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me shall live, and whoever, even in death, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for William, the family, the friends, all who have gathered here to say farewell. Dry the tears of those who weep. Father, Lord, accept their prayers on behalf of William as he prepared to enter into the realms of that kingdom you provided for him. John 14:1-6, of which I quote verses 6. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also too. Yes, someday, my brothers and sisters, we will join William. It is no if, no buts. We all have to go to that station someday. All we have to do is prepare ourselves. As you heard the scripture, I am the resurrection and the life. After death, people have a saying, when you're dead, you're done. I detest and race away that notion. When you're dead, life has now begun. So therefore, trust in God with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. We shall now sing the hymn. Oh, what a force!
bright and warm star.
All I need to cleanse and make me truly whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my strength. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley,
a bright and morning star.
He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
All my grief has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power.
In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my strength. He tells me every care of him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill.
In sorrow comfort, in trouble he's my strength. He tells me every care of him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairy.
Remember all the good Bumi have done. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Welcome him into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who mourn. Comfort them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lighten their sense of loss with your presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Increase their faith and strengthen their hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray also for ourselves on our pilgrimage through this life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of holiness and power, accept our prayers on behalf of your servant. Do not count his deeds against him, for in his will and his heart, he desired to do your will. As his faith united him in your people on earth, so may your mercy join him to the angels in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful. You are attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need and strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Sleep on, Bumi, sleep on, and take your rest until that appointed time come, whereby you are summoned to be with your Maker. You have just short rest, 3 days in the tomb, and then he would call upon you and say, Bumi, 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 get up. I'm ready to ask you a few questions. And you would answer with candor. So sleep on and take your rest. May the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of the Son and of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And may Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down and remain with each and every one of you all here gathered to say farewell now and forevermore. Amen. My dear family and friends of Bumi, it is a great privilege, I say, to be part of this farewell service with Father Paul. For those who didn't get my name inside the church, my name is Deacon George Way. I was attached to Bumi. How many years, I cannot recall. My father had a house at the bottom of Burks Road in Bridensill. So I am a Bridensillian. I know the full recourse. And beyond that, I joined the taxi business, driving the taxi out there, Z567. So I know Bumi pretty well. Sleep on, Bumi, and to the relatives, friends, and family, I say to you, let not your heart be troubled. Trust in God.
trust also in the Father.
Amen.
In his Father's house are many mansions, or some people say translation rooms. He go to prepare a place for you and also me. That where he is, we may be also. Keep the faith as Bumi did. I think I see Bumi now walking up and down through the cathedral, picking up the offering and saying hallelujah, because our God today is risen. Hallelujah. God bless you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn